Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. In the 8th chapter, we saw how Lord Krishna protected the child in Uttara's womb and how Kunti Devi offered her prayers to him and Yudhishthira brooding over the death of his relatives. So in this 9th chapter, Suta says King Yudhishthira, afraid of the wrongs he did by killing so many people in war, he proceeded to Vinashana. It's another name for Kurukshetra, where Bhishmacharya lay on his bed of arrows. All his brothers followed him and also sages Vyasa Dhaumya, who was the family priest of Yudhishthira. Krishna also rode in a chariot along with Arjuna. They all went to meet Bhishma, who was lying on the ground like a god fallen from heaven and looking so resplendent. The Pandavas as well as Krishna offered obeisances to him. After knowing that Krishna is coming to meet Bhishma, all the sages like Narada, Dhaumya, Vedavyasa, Bharadvaja, Parashurama, Vasistha, Vishwamitra, and even Sri Shuka and many others gathered there. Seeing all those highly blessed souls assembled there, Bhishma paid his respects to them. Then he looked at Pandavas, who sat beside him. His eyes welled up with tears of affection and spoke to them and said, Aho kashtam, aho nyayam. How painful and how unjust it had been that you have lived a life of suffering, which you surely did not deserve. When the great warrior Pandu breathed his last, you were all tender of age, and my daughter-in-law Pritha, Kunti, along with you, had to suffer many hardships. I believe all those hardships were because of fate or time. Sarvam kala kritam manye. Just as when the wind flows, all the clouds move in the direction of the wind, like that everybody in this world are ruled over by time. It's understandable if an ordinary person goes through this, but you, Yudhishthira, son of Dharma, Bhima holding a mace in his hand, Arjuna being archer with Gandiva the bow, and where Shri Krishna is the friend and well-wisher, to think of such adversities even there, certainly no one can ever discover the true intention of Shri Krishna. Therefore, taking all this in your stride as fate, follow his will and protect the helpless people as you are their sole monarch. And then he points to Krishna and tells Yudhishthira, Eshavai Bhagavan Sakshad Adyo Narayanav Puman. Shri Krishna is God himself. He is no other than Lord Narayana. Deluding the world by his Maya, he is moving among us as though he is one among us. No one else other than Lord Shiva, Narada and Lord Kapila know the most hidden glory of Shri Krishna, whom you think to be your cousin, friend and whom you made your counselor, messenger and even charioteer. Though he looks upon all with the same I, Samadarshaha, and is free from egotism and is blemishless, yet look at his compassion for those who are exclusively devoted to him. See how he has appeared in person before me at this hour when I am about to give up my body. A yogi who sheds his body with his thoughts fixed on Krishna and chanting his name is released from the bondage of actions and attains the highest state. May that Lord, possessed of four arms, who appears to others only in their meditation, stay on here till I cast off my body. Bhishmacharya is now awaiting the Uttarayana Punya Kalam, which is said to be a very auspicious time to shed one's body. So now as Yudhishthira, hearing this, asks Bhima questions concerning a variety of dharmas. Bhishma, who had realized the truth, narrates one by one the various dharmas which should be followed by men with due regard to their varna and ashrama, and the twofold dharmas. One dharma involving the world activity called Pravritti Dharma, and those which is going away from worldly pleasures, which is called Nivritti Dharma. He also explained dharmas relating to gifts, duties of kings, moksha dharma, stri dharma, bhagavad dharma, and also about four purusharthas, dharma, artha, kama, and moksha, how to attain all of them. During his discourse, he also blessed us with Vishnu Sahasranama Stotram. That is why it's in the form of conversation between Yudhishthira and Bhishmacharya in front of all rishis and Krishna himself. While he was thus discoursing of dharma, there arrived the time when the sun changed its course towards north, which is called Uttarayana. Yogis are said to be Chanda Mrityu. Bhishmacharya is also one such yogi who can shed his body whenever he wanted. So now Bhishma wound up his speech, exclusively fixed his mind, which was absolutely free from worldly attachment, as well as his eyes on Shri Krishna, who was present before him in his four-armed form clad in shining yellow robes. The last traces of sin left in him were destroyed, and the pain which he felt on account of the arrows piercing his body disappeared at a mere glance of the Lord. Now, while casting off his body, he stopped all the activities and wanderings of his senses and extolled Shri Krishna in the form of a prayer called Bhishma Stuti. This stuti comprises of 11 verses offering the Lord his 10 indriyas and mind. Bhishma starts by saying, I offer my mind, which is free from all thirst for worldly enjoyment, to the Bhagavan Shri Krishna, who is Satvata Pungave, who is supreme among all Yadavas, who is Vibhumni, which means Mahat, great, Swasukham Upagate, one who is always reveling in the joy and bliss of his own self, but Kwachid Vihartum, sometimes when he wants to do some Leela, then what he does? Prakriti Mupeyushi, he assumes his own Maya in order to carry on his Leela, from which flows the stream of creation. In the next verse, he describes the beauty of Krishna's form. He says, Shri Krishna attracts everyone in the three planetary systems, all the three worlds, Tribhuvana Kamanam, Tamala Varnam, Krishna, who has blue color as a Tamala Vriksha. This Tamala tree has a dark bluish black hue. So Krishna has this beautiful color, and the flowers in this Tamala tree have a golden color, and Goddess Lakshmi, who is seated in Vishnu's heart, she looks like the flowers of the Tamala tree. This comparison of Krishna with Tamala tree is also mentioned in Kanakadhara Stotram. Krishna is wearing yellow colored robes, which is compared to the brilliance of the rays of the sun. Krishna's face is looking like a lotus flower, and all his curly locks of hair, which are black in color, are all around his face. His face looks as if a lotus flower is surrounded by a swarm of bees. So Bhishma says that Krishna, who is Vijaya Sakhe, who is friend of Arjuna, Rati Rastume, let me have Rati or devotion for that Krishna. Let me have blemishless love for Krishna, which is without any desire, any return, without expectations. Anavadya Rati Rastume. In the next verse, he says, in the war, when Krishna was riding the chariot, the horses were galloping so fast that the dust from horses' hoofs rose in the air and got settled in the curly locks of hair of Krishna. And because of the exertion, Krishna was sweating. Those drops of sweat were looking like beads of pearls on his face. His skin was being pierced by sharp arrows discharged by me, even though he was wearing an armor. Krishna accepted all those arrows in his chest as if they were flowers offered during Archana. May my mind, body, and soul rest in that Sri Krishna. In the next verse, Bhishmacharya mentions the beginning of Mahabharata war. He says, Sapadi Sakhi Vacho Nishamya. On the battlefield, on the command of the friend, Krishna immediately drove the chariot and placed his chariot in the middle of Pandavas and Kaurava Sena. As Arjuna said in Bhagavad Gita, Senayor Ubhayor Madhye Ratham Sthapaya Mechyuta. And Krishna stood there And what did Krishna do? Parasainikayuhu akshna hritavati. As he showed Arjuna the warriors on the other side, he snatched their lives from them by his mere glance. After that, whoever fought with Pandavas were only the lifeless warriors. So let me have such rati and devotion to Krishna, who is the Parthasarathi. In the next verse, Bhishma says, what happened when Arjuna saw the generals of the Kaurava forces standing in the middle of both sides in the war? His body starts trembling and his bow Gandiva slipped through his hands as he regarded killing his own kith and kin a sin. He had refused to fight. At that time, Krishna imparted Arjuna with spiritual knowledge in the form of Bhagavad Gita and dispelled his illusion that he is the doer and he would be the killer by teaching him Atmavidya. So he says, may I be blessed with devotion to the feet of that supreme being. In the next verse, Bhishmacharya says, breaking his own vow that he will not take up any weapon in the war, Shri Krishna jumped down from his chariot like a lion that pounces upon an elephant to kill him, rushed towards me with a wheel of his chariot in his hand, the earth trembling under his feet and his upper garment dropping behind him. He decided to break his promise just to fulfill my vow that I shall make Krishna take up a weapon. How did he do that? Bhishma one day started fighting aggressively with Arjuna and poured a volley of weapons towards him, which made him helpless. Krishna, noticing Arjuna is fighting half-heartedly and didn't want to hurt Bhishma, had to take a weapon to stir up Arjuna. But in fact, Krishna wanted the world to know that vow of a bhakta always succeeds, and for this, he was prepared to forego his own vow. In the next verse, Bhishma says, being hit with a piercing arrow discharged by me and bathed in blood and with his armor broken, he who rushed with so much of force to kill me as I tried to harm Arjuna. Arjuna tried to stop Krishna by holding his feet, by saying, Krishna, don't forget your vow that you will not take weapon, so please don't go. But Krishna disregarded his pleads. May that Lord Mukunda be my asylum. And in the next verse, he says how the chariot of Arjuna has become the family for Krishna, and he protects the family as a householder. He took the charioteer's whip in one hand and held the horse's reins in another and looked most attractive in the charming role. Everyone who died in the Kaurava side, after seeing this beautiful form of Parthasarathi, they have all merged with Krishna, attaining a form similar to his, called Sarupya Mukti. May I, in my last moments, develop love for that Lord. In the next verse, Bhishmacharya thinks of the gopis. He says, Krishna with his charming gait, graceful movements and winsome smiles, his loving glances during the famous Rasa Leela at Vrindavan, Krishna gave all this to the gopis. So whenever they got all this from Krishna, they used to feel so proud of themselves, thinking they were the most fortunate women in the world. Then in their blind love for Krishna, they began to imitate his actions. Having done all that, they became one with Krishna. In the next verse, he says, in an assembly crowded with hosts of sages and princes during Rajasuya sacrifice performed by Yudhishthira, Shri Krishna, who attracted the eyes of them all, had the honor of being worshipped first. That Krishna is now right before my eyes. How fortunate am I? In the final verse, he says, now I am merged with Krishna. That unborn Krishna is present in everyone's heart as their antaryami. He is giving an example like how the sun is only one in the sky, but everyone looks at sun with their eyes. For each one's eyes, it appears as one sun. Similarly, though Krishna is birthless and his non-dual Brahman, he is present in the heart of all created beings as their antaryami. So now I have merged with that Krishna, he says. Having thus merged his soul, speech and visual sense in Krishna, Bhishma breathed his last. All those present there became silent, just as birds do at the close of the day. Then God started to beat kettle drums dundubhi and showers of flowers were poured from heaven. Yudhishthira performed Bhishmacharya's funeral rites and sages who were gathered there extolled Krishna uttering his names and with Krishna in their heart they returned to their hermitages. With this 9th chapter of Srimad Bhagavatam book 1 comes to an end. Hare Krishna.